forget. But yeah, we'll give it another couple of minutes, then we'll begin. So this is the final part in our series on broadly speaking, women's issues. The first one we spoke about how we think about feminism, or how I think about feminism, I guess, and read it in light of Bereshit. The second subject we spoke about last week was looking at the question of tzniut and how we explain tzniut in the kind of rubric of Judaism that prizes physicality at the same time as prizing spirituality. And we spoke a little bit about how to approach it. And tonight, I'm taking a slightly different track, and we're going to be looking at not the question really of women's learning, because that probably deserves its own series in and of itself in terms of the sources. We'll do a few sources, but I'm going to be looking, the volume is low. Better now? Better, okay. I'm going to be looking at a few sources, but mainly looking at this question of the revolution of women's learning, because I would say that the revolution of women's learning is one of the more successful changes that the halakha has undergone in the last 100 years. It's felt in every corner of the Orthodox world, and it's also something that obviously us and Mizrahi think is very important. And to think about how revolutions or how changes take place. And I'll say at the outset, ruin the ending. It's not the same story that most people assume. So I'll leave that in the air, but I'll begin with a story. When I first arrived in Manchester, my Hebrew is impacting my English. When I first arrived here, I was discussing with someone, doesn't matter who, one of the fathers at my son's football match, about the level of Kodesh in Israel. And this particular father, not Haredi by any means, he says, and I said, you know, and my daughter, who Tila's now in grade year 8, so she was in grade, she went into year 6, so she had just finished year 4 in Israel. What's year 4 in Israel, but was year 5 here. It does finish learning Vayikra the whole year and learning about the Korbanot and the various halachot of the Korbanot in year 4 in Israel. So, and that's at the state level. This isn't an advanced school. So he looked at me, he's like, oh, Korbanot. I don't know if we, that's a good thing for girls to be learning such a high level of Torah, right? So my answer to him was I don't think you can compartmentalize things like that. Meaning you can stop and say, well, even if we put, it doesn't matter how, like, we're going to stop women learning at this level because anything above this level is not shayach for them, right? You can do that, and there are people that do that and take that approach. But all that I think means is that everything is just moved down a level, and then, you know, no one really knows very much. And certainly in the world in which we live, where women have access to free, high education, to limit women that way is can only lead to the problems. But what we're going to be looking at largely tonight is the question of Sarah Schenirer and the Beit Yaakov movement. And we'll have a look at it from a number of different angles. I'm going to show you a video. I'm not going to show you this part. At the beginning of the video, the Rav who's talking says that according to, he quotes someone saying that Sarah Schenirer has done more for Torah learning in the last 100 years than anyone else. That's a Haredi video. But what we'll begin is just as an overview, just to kind of understand the issues, broadly speaking, although this probably isn't the best thing to be doing, we'll start with just one source, basically, tied to women's Torah learning. Here's a picture of one of the first Beit Yaakov schools. So I'm trying to move this around. as I say, this isn't a good place to start because I'm not really going to delve into sources as much as share kind of machshava. But the sources that we are important to know, because I think this is important, is the Rambam. The Rambam begins his laws of Hilchot Torah, Talmud Torah, the laws of learning Torah, as saying as follows. Women, slaves, and infants are absolved from the study of the Torah. But the father is obliged to instruct his infant son in the Torah, for it said, you shall teach them, your children talking of them. But a woman is not charged to teach her son, for only one obliged to study is obliged to instruct. So already here, you see at the outset that women are not charged with Talmud Torah in the same way as men are. And they're also not obliged to teach their children in the same way that men are. So already you have this discrepancy. That being said, it's taken a little bit further. In the Rambam, later on, at the end of the first parak of Hilchot Talmud Torah, it says as follows. A woman who studied the Torah as a reward has a reward coming to her, but it is incomparable to the reward of a man because she was not commanded to do so. And whosoever does something which is not mandatory upon him to perform, receives not a high equal to the higher of him who is commanded to perform it, but less than his. But by this, that's quoting the famous Gemara in Kiddushin, Kol Mitzuveh, anyone who's commanded gets a higher reward. It's machlok in the Rishonim, by the way, what that actually means. Because what does it mean they get a higher reward? So the simple reading is they get a higher reward, right? There are more, however you calculate mitzvot points in mind. But another reading offered by the Balei Tosfot is that people who do things that they're not required to do won't perform them at the same level as someone who's required to. Mitzvah comes and essentially necessitates the person to perform it at a higher level. But again, that's just a kind of a bracket. And then he goes and says, and although she has a reward coming, the sages commanded that a man shall not instruct his daughter in the Torah, because most women have no set mind to be instructed therein. But on the contrary, are apt to divert matters of the Torah to nonsensical matters, of course, in proportion to the inferiority of their mind. Right? Very difficult words from the Rambam. The sages said, whoever instructs his daughter in Torah does no better than if he instructed her in matters of profanity. These matters are thus spoken of only concerning the oral Torah, but respecting holy writ, it is best not to begin to instruct her therein. But if he did instruct her, it is not as if he instructs her in profanity. Right? Tiflut, in the words of the Gemara. So these are pretty harif words, right, against the women's Talmud Torah. But there are a few issues with this. The one issue is we know that there were enlightened, very learned women, even in the times of the Gemara, right? So how is it that we have women who know how to learn, but we have here, for instance, the Rambam, who can't read Pascha, that is brought down also in the Shulchan Aruch, that a man should not teach his daughter words of Torah, right? So we see already there's a tension around women's learning, already from the classical sources, already from the Gemara, that there seems to be an issue with women learning. Now, there's, in the modern period, where this became a question, we'll kind of contextualize it a bit more in a second, but in the modern period, when this became a question, people said, well, you know, how are we meant to understand this? Or is there room for women to learn Talmud Torah in the same way as a man does? So many poskim debate this issue, and essentially they come down, many come down, and some still come down and say that you can't teach women the oral Torah, you can't teach them Talmud, and particularly more Haredi circles, that is generally what happens. But in other circles and other poskim come down and feel that has changed. For a number of reasons. How do they deal with the Rambam? Firstly, because, for instance, Rav Henkin, and if anyone wants, there's a great compilation of his responsa in English about contemporary women's issues. You can borrow it, or I can take pictures of it. Discusses this issue at length, and he, by the way, set up a very important midrashah for women, and he basically says, you might read the Rambam more specifically. There's something specific about a man teaching his daughter to learn, but not necessarily a man teaching anyone else, or if women learn by themselves, or if women learn in chavrusas, like it seems to be implied from the Yerushalmi, that women are able to learn by themselves. They're just not able, they shouldn't learn with men, or they shouldn't learn from men, right? And he goes on and says, certainly in our time, where women are able to engage in secular studies at a high level, it does the opposite of the intention of the Rambam to prevent them from learning Talmud Torah, right? Because he says here, many women aren't able to learn, but in our time, many women are able to learn. So if you're going to come and say, well, women can be doctors, women can be dentists, women can be accountants, women can be school principals, right? But they can't learn Talmud, they can't learn Talmud. So that seems to create great issues. More than that, there are poskim like Rav Soloveitchik that felt that women should at the very least study the halachot that is incumbent upon them, right? Which is a large section of halachot. And not only the halachot, but in order to study halachot, you also have to understand the background. And Rav Soloveitchik famously opened the first Talmud shiur in Yeshiva University that when it began. And he was a big proponent of women's learning. And his daughter, Esti Rosenberg, set up the Midrashah in Migdal Oz. His granddaughter, Esti Rosenberg, set up the Midrashah in Migdal Oz, which is famous Midrashah today. And there were other famous poskim, like the Lubavitch Rebbe, that also felt that women should have an active part in Talmud Torah and prepare for Moshiach in his framing. So we see that this question has come to the fore in the modern world, and really in many ways represents how the modern world has changed, or how things do change. I was asked this question in my shiur on Thursday night. We were talking about women's hair cuffing. We were looking at the sources. And again, not getting into the sources, but a lot of it's dependent on time and place. And so someone asked the question, hang on, so does that mean that halakha changes based on time and place, right? Because the assumption is that it doesn't. But the truth is that it does, right? The halakha changes based on time and place. The Torah changes based on time and place. Many people, if they heard that, would probably get very angry. But it's not that the Torah and the halakha changes based on time and place. It's that the Torah, the spirit of the Torah and the halakha is constant, but in order to apply it to time and place, so things come out differently depending on how the circumstances in the time and place. And that's why we also need the gedolim and the poskim of our generation to guide us into how we reapply Torah in different ways, in different formats. And outwardly, Torah does change between time and place, but not perhaps as much as some people would want, and not as little as other people would want. I will leave it as that. So again, these are just a background to the sources. The other thing we do know is that women historically did not have organized learning opportunities in much of the Jewish world, right? And that was true. And the truth is, I think historically most women didn't have learning opportunities in much of the world, and as neither did men, but certainly women, although there are different times and places throughout antiquity and elsewhere where that was the case. And whereas men did have access to organized Torah study and organized things, and women didn't have much of history, and that started to change in the modern world because of the various changes that took place, right? People had to then reevaluate this and say, well, what does it mean that women don't have Talmud Torah opportunities in the modern world, right? What does that lead to? And so what we will begin with is basically, I'll show you a video from Sarah Schenirer, about Sarah Schenirer, which is the kind of the typical way of understanding Sarah Schenirer, which I'm going to take apart to talk a bit more about how we revolutionize things and how things actually change when we're thinking about women's issues, but the truth is other issues as well. Now, Sarah Schenirer, just so we can have some background, set up the Beit Yaakov movement in the early part of the 20th century, right? She actually, she's from Krakow in Poland. And actually, when we take groups, obviously we go visit the first school she set up. And also there's a commemoration where she was buried. Unfortunately, the cemetery was destroyed by the Nazis, but there is a commemoration for her grave. And she was from Krakow, and actually she got caught in Vienna during the war. And in Vienna, she was exposed to the thinking and the kind of orthodoxy of Rav Hirsch's orthodoxy, Torim Derech Eretz, a more modern orthodoxy, you would say. And there she writes in her diary that that the rabbi in shul addressed the women when he was speaking, or addressed issues pertaining to women. And she said in Krakow that never would have happened. The rabbis never would have spoken to women in that way, and it got her thinking about all different possibilities. And when she returned to Krakow, she worked as a seamstress, and she realized that the girls in Krakow knew very little, and they weren't interested in Judaism. They also didn't know Torah, and so because of that kind of coming together of her experiences, she set a goal to start educating women and set up girls' schools, which until that time was a chidush. It wasn't a chidush as much of a revolution in Western Europe, in Vienna, right, and elsewhere. It was certainly a revolution in Poland at the time. But let's just select this. Okay, let me show you a video though about how we know. Well, let's start actually from this letter. This is a famous letter from the Chafetz Chaim, written to Sarah Schenirer, praising her efforts and explaining how he supports the Beit Yaakov movement. And let me just read it and then watch the video. So he writes, "Kasher shemati shenadvu anashim yirim v'charedim, I heard there were people who volunteered, who were charedi l'dvar Hashem, there are very few people, to set up schools of Beit Yaakov to teach Torah and Yirat Shamayim and Derech Eretz to the girls. Amati l'po'alam hatov, yishar achem chilam, that Hashem should strengthen your steps and help you through, etc., in order to avoid apostasy, Rahman al-Atsan, that happens to happen in this generation, etc., etc." And he says, "And all the suspicions and the pikpukim, and all of the suspicions and the issues that people have, that they're worried about teaching the girls Torah based on the Rambam, which we saw, ain shum beit michush lazeh b'meinu eile. There's no reason to be worried about this in our days. Bein kan hamakom leve barichu." I'm not going to explain this at length, but this is one of the sources he writes in elsewhere, that all of the concerns that are voiced by the Rambam and other poskim and people who go according to them, there's no room for that, and you should teach your girls in especially Beit Yaakov, and he spoke Beit Yaakov. And he says, "Ki lo kedorot rishonim doroteinu, our generations are not like the previous generation. Right, there was a tradition in every Jewish house, mothers and fathers, to go in the way of the Torah and to read Tenu Rena every Shabbos Kodesh. Masha'en ken bavonotenu harabim b'doratenu ele, what we don't have in our generation. V'al ken b'chol oz v'tenu rosenu aleinu shtadel avot b'tei sefer." He says, and so because in our generation, people don't have family traditions. People don't learn these things at home. Therefore, in our generation, we have to go and strengthen these schools to make accessible the Torah that was ordinarily passed down from father and mother to child. Right? Again, talking to how we meant to understand the advent of women's learning in light of the clear traditions that girls never had formal education. So the Chafetz Chaim suggests that in previous generations, the girls never had formal education, but they had training and education in their homes, something that doesn't happen today, and therefore you need schools. Now, what I want to say is that many times people say as follows, right? The Tzara Schenirer set up the Beit Yaakov school only after getting the Haskama of the Gedolim. And they bring, for instance, the letter of the Chafetz Chaim and other letters that were written. And I want to argue that's not exactly true, which I think is important. Let me show you this video, which is like a classic video. It was a video put out, I think, by the Agda on her 80th yard site. And let's just hear.
Girls to embrace the Torah ideal and teach them how to love the Rabbeinu Shel Olam and help them reach their true goals in life. She wanted to start a religious school for girls, but many were opposed to her idea. Her own brother was against it. She had a brother in Czechoslovakia and she wrote him. She said, "Why don't we ask the Belzer Rebbe? Let's see what he says about teaching Torah and giving frum education to girls." And her brother said, "Okay, let's go to Marienbad. That's where the Belzer Rebbe is." And in Marienbad, they sent in a kvittel to the Rebbe, and they wrote, The brother wrote, "My sister wants to begin teaching girls Torah, and she wants to teach Jewish education." And Sarah Schneer wrote in her diary, she was in the room when the Rebbe said these words, "Bracha v'hatzlacha." Her brother almost fainted. He couldn't believe it. But now she felt so energized because she was validated and the Rebbe understood what she wanted to do. And she went and she had this same question asked to the Chofetz Chaim and to Rav Chaim Isaac Grzinski. They were the leaders of Klal Yisrael, and both of them agreed that now was the time to teach Jewish girls Torah, to teach Jewish girls about mitzvahs and what Yadis was all about, and to start these schools. And finally, they decided to go to the Imre Emes. The Imre Emes, the sister of the Imre Emes, went in to ask the Rebbe what his opinion was about girls' education, and he too consented and said it was the right thing to do at this time. Now she was energized. Now she was not going to be stopped. She never went back to sewing again. Now her mind and her heart was set on teaching girls Torah.
Okay, so that is kind of the classic way the story is told about Sarah Schneerer, right? That she went and she got haskamot from all the leading gdolim of the generation. As I said, the Belzer Rebbe, they were Belzer Chassidim, and the Imre Emes, the Rav Chaim Oizer, and also the Chafetz Chaim. And only once she received the haskamot, then she went ahead, right? And it's kind of held up as a paradigm of the way change is meant to happen in halachic discourse, certainly in kind of the Haredi world. Also the Tzilumi world, that how it meant to happen. Sarah Schneerer is the example and the epitome of this approach. However, the truth is a little bit more murky, because actually this letter from the Chofetz Chaim is only written in 1933, right? And so it comes about 15 years after she started the Beit Yaakov school. And it was only after the Agudat Yisrael, which is the leading Haredi political party in Poland, supported the Beit Yaakov school. And they garnered letters from leading Gedolim, largely because they needed to convince people, right? And there were various places where people were still unconvinced, also to gain funding. Now, the truth is, though, that doesn't mean she didn't ask the opinion of Gedolim. She did ask the opinion of the Belzer Rebbe. Right, and this is what he quoted from her diary. She says, "I could not get my dream of establishing religious school for girls out of my head." Right, so she comes back from Vienna with this idea to revolutionize Jewish education, to revolutionize Torah education for girls. And she, by the way, she writes also when she first started, because she was a seamstress, and she noticed that the girls were more interested in their dresses than in Torah. And then in HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And so when she started with older girls, and she felt that they had become too secularized already, because already at that time in Poland, even though Poland was more traditional than Western Europe, the girls were becoming more assimilated much more quickly. And so she felt it had to start with younger girls. But then she writes, "I could not get my dream of establishing a religious school for girls out of my head. At first, my brother laughed at me. 'Why do you want to start busying yourself with political parties?' he wrote back. When I asked him that I was firmly resolved not to abandon this mission, he wrote to me, 'No, let us go to Marienbad, where the Belzer Rebbe is now, and we'll hear whether the Tzaddik of the generation agrees to it.' There was no end to my joy. Although I did not have much money, I hurriedly prepared myself for the trip. When I arrived in Marienbad, I and my brother went in immediately to the Belzer Rav. My brother, who was a Ben Bayit there, wrote in his kvittel, 'She wants to educate Jewish daughters in the Jewish derech.' And I heard the answer from the Tzaddik's holy mouth myself, 'Bracha v'aslacha.' The words were like the most expensive balsam oil, instilling fresh courage in my limbs. The blessing from the great Tzaddik gave me the best hope that my strivings would be fulfilled." So you see here someone who is driven with a mission, and she knows it to be true, and she's also very, very holy, right? And really has Yirat Shamayim, and she kind of was going to do it anyway, but her brother convinced her to ask the Belzer Rebbe, and the Belzer Rebbe said bracha v'aslacha, and that really did energize her. right? The haskamot that come later is something else. But after this, it was enough for her to start and to start operating. I will say also again, in brackets, that the Belzer Rebbe himself didn't recommend for Belzer Hasidim to send their girls to the schools, right? But certainly he was behind, and she had her his haskama. And this is another thing that that was written explaining how they got the Chafetz Chaim's letter of support. So she wrote to, they had trouble in a particular town setting up a Beis Yaakov school. And so she wrote, if the local Rav will not support you, you will not make it. You're not going to be able to set up a school if the Rav will be against it. And she says, this is Sarah Schenirer. And most interesting, we had the same trouble with his brother in another city. He too opposed our school. And the Aguda wrote to the Chafetz Chaim, and his reply will soon be published in our magazine, number 106. In that city, we lost 70 girls to the other Haskalah schools. We were too late. And so you see here very interesting things as well, right? Firstly, the Chafetz Chaim's letter was garnered as support to open up further Beit Yaakov schools. It wasn't the original letters we saw. But we also see, you understand the urgency of what she's talking about. And I think that urgency is no less today. In that school, we lost 70 girls to the Haskalah schools, right? To the schools, essentially the enlightened, the assimilationists, and they weren't able to enter the school because the rabbis opposed women's learning, right? And just because things have advanced, perhaps, that doesn't mean that the same issues are no longer at play. So I wanted just to end off and talk a little bit about some thoughts in light of what we've seen, and note a few things. Firstly, the question of women's learning has largely become it still is a question whether women should learn Gemara or what level they should learn, as we saw with my story. But I think in many ways it's important for us to think about what are the effects of not teaching girls Gemara, or what are the effects of limiting their education when we live in a world which actually promotes women's education, right? And what are the effects on Yiddishkeit of women having a very meager knowledge of Judaism, a meager knowledge of Jewish texts, right? Because if you limit them, as I replied to that father, if you limit them in one area of Judaism and you say, no, so girls can learn, but only until a certain point, then you necessarily limit their openness to learning, right? You necessarily limit their desire to learn as well at a high level, right? And I don't think in our world it's practical for that to happen. I don't think in our world it's practical to say to someone, you can learn, but only the first, the first svarim of Tanakh. After that, it becomes, it's not really your tchum. And we even saw from the Rambam, the women are not forbidden from learning. Women who learn are not the same level of men, but certainly, historically speaking, there were important women who were very knowledgeable as well, and knowledgeable in Torah. And finally, just to note, Sarah Schneira, usually the paradigm is that the way revolution operates is the way Sarah Schneira operated. First, she went around and got the haskamot of all the gdolim and all the rabbanim, and then she set up the Beit Yaakov school. Whereas actually, that's not exactly true. She got the haskama of the Belzer Rav, who was an important Rav in his day, right? It wasn't just some, unimportant local rabbi. She was driven by a mission that was full of Yirat Shamayim, and she knew and she saw the damage that was being done by taking a different approach, an approach that was distancing women from Torah, and she started. She started with her revolution even before she had haskamot from all the gdolim, and then later on she received political support, and then later on she received further haskamot, right? And I think actually in many ways that's how change and revolution in general happens, right? It's a little bit, there's no chicken and egg. It's a little bit one and the other until eventually a snowball happens if it is in the right path. And today, in addition, obviously, to there being the Beit Yaakov movement worldwide, there are obviously huge movements of women's learning throughout the world. And it really has been, in many ways, the most successful revolution change, and has brought the most successful improvements, I would say, to Judaism and Jewish life that we've seen in probably the last 100 years. Does anyone have any comments or questions? Okay, fine. So I've convinced you. but I will just add that obviously one of the focuses of our activities here is the Women's Beit Midrash for that reason, right? That we believe that women's learning is essential to the development not only of women but also of men in Judaism, and that we've been zochet to see that in the last 10 to 20 years, where more learned women have been able to engage in discussions in the Jewish world. And I think that you can't underestimate the benefit that has brought for us as well. So thank you very much. And I think Laura will be... Yes.
Can I record it? Are the other 2 weeks recorded as well? Could I have a copy of it, please?
The first one is, and the second one is not, unfortunately.
And tonight is?
Yes.
Okay, could Laura send... Laura's got my number... Sorry, yeah. Your rabbi has my number.
Yeah,
can
fine.
She WhatsApp it to me?
Yeah, I'll tell her. Yeah, I'll tell her she's sitting here. Okay, thank you so much. Laura's will begin in 5 minutes, right, Laura?
Good Chodesh, thank you.
It'll begin at 2:15. Chodesh Tov.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Thanks, Rav Ari. Bye.